Welcome to Module 1 of Lean Six Sigma Yellow Belt Training. Module 1 covers Six Sigma Fundamentals. It's broken into three sub-modules, 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3 for size considerations. Module 1-1 covers Six Sigma Foundations and Principles, Lean Foundations and Principles, Six Sigma Roles and Responsibilities. I'm a certified Six Sigma Black Belt with the American Society of Quality, and I'll be conducting your training. Here we see all the areas of the body of knowledge, again, covered in Module 1. Again, this submodule 1-1 covers A, B, and C. You'll find in this entire Module 1 of Six Sigma Fundamentals, it will cover pretty much all of the entire body of knowledge you'll need to know as a yellow belt. It's a complete comprehensive overview. It's kind of like the dump truck's going to back up and dump the whole thing on you. So we'll go over the whole of Lean Six Sigma. And then what we'll do then is we move into the remaining modules that are organized by the DMAIC method. We'll revisit most all of these concepts again, and you'll see them a second time in a second context. And we'll cover all of that. It is a data-driven philosophy of improvement. The term Six Sigma, the name, was developed by Motorola, the body of knowledge for the most part that we know now, and made famous by Jack Welch at GE. It's also really been now combined with Lean, and I think it's best to look at Lean and Six Sigma as an entire body, comprehensive body of knowledge, as a continuum, and that certainly we're going to break Six Sigma concepts and Lean concepts out separately in this training. But in practice, it's a continuum of tools you use to improve in the enterprise. The value that Six Sigma brings to an organization is important. The organization has to believe that Lean Six Sigma is worth doing. Cross-functional team problem solving is a key aspect of Lean Six Sigma. Lean and Six Sigma is evidence-based decision making, where Six Sigma is famous for the use of statistics. But they both use objective criteria. They emphasize a methodical approach. Six Sigma tends to use the acronym DMAIC, which will be the acronym we used in this course. Also is PDCA, which we'll cover, but it's using the scientific method or a standard methodology to close a gap between a current state that you're unsatisfied with to an improved state with a permanent solution that is sustained. It promotes a management environment where improvements are made in critical areas. This is your constraints, your theory constraints, your vital factors. What areas in the business, what problems do you have or areas for improvement are the most critical for improvement? And those are the ones you want to attack. Now in Lean, you do have the Kaizen philosophy, which we'll cover, where you have general incremental improvement across the board, a philosophy of general continuing improvement, and that's healthy and good, but you also want to focus on those items, your squeakiest hinge, what is constraining your business from being where you want to be, and you certainly want to attack those with a priority focus. The term Six Sigma has several meanings. We'll go over these probably several times during this training. I think, first of all, it is a business philosophy. Lean Six Sigma is a business philosophy where you've adopted a methodical continuous improvement where you measure your return on that investment and you use a standard method. And it has manifested itself in the term DMAIC, PDCA. It's process-based. Lean Six Sigma is process-based. With respect to Six Sigma proper, what you see there is the fundamental equation of Six Sigma, or Y, your dependent variable, or that which you're trying to improve. Your problem depends on factors, and these factors, rather than randomly based on guessing, you try to find and prove what your vital factor, or sometimes called your red X's, are. And this principle is true whether it's Lean or Six Sigma. The Y equal F of X, or the problem is dependent on factors, is a Six Sigma, tends to be a Six Sigma terminology. Some key terms that you'll want to know about and become comfortable with are critical to quality factors. That's basically the Y. It's determined by the voice of the customer, which we'll cover to a great extent. So the voice of the customer determines what's critical to your quality, and that's your dependent or your Y factors. And they're driven by independent variables, or what's critical to the process. The process has its own voice, and it drives your Y factors. They're the voice of the process. Some of those factors are more critical than others. They're your vital factors, your constraints, your squeakiest hinge. They're your red X's. You want to attack those and maximize your return on your efforts and investment. Again, the term Six Sigma has several meanings depending on context. First of all, I think it represents a methodology around an accepted body of knowledge. DMAIC is the Six Sigma step representation. It's not in conflict with the Plan-Do-Check-Act cycle, which is the DMAIC cycle. It's associated a little bit more with Lean and ISO and other areas that had been developed before Six Sigma. One can be mapped into the other. Six Sigma also, in addition to representing a methodology, is a large set of tools for process improvement. So we'll probably touch upon this again, but Lean Six Sigma is a set of concepts and a set of tools. And sometimes you're concept-centric and sometimes you're tool-centric on what you're doing, but you have to remember that you want to deal first with concepts and apply the right tool. You have qualitative and quantitative tools. They drive process improvement. Lean Six Sigma revolves around the basic quality engineering tools. There's eight basic quality tools, and they're the core of the tool set of Lean Six Sigma, and we'll certainly go over those very carefully because the basic tools are certainly the ones that are important to a yellow belt. The Lean Six Sigma tool set is a state-of-the-art comprehensive set of tools and knowledge and concepts, but there are no hard boundaries. There are other improvement methodologies that we would, of course, always want to be open to. There's value engineering, value analysis. There's no boundaries on Lean Six Sigma tool set. You want to do what you need to do to improve your process. And finally, Six Sigma represents a metric. In simple terms, Six Sigma performance means 3.4 defects per million opportunities. And we'll go over that. So it's a philosophy, it's a tool set, and it's a literal metric of Lean Six Sigma. On the top, we kind of have milestones that are in the Six Sigma camp. On the below the blue line, the timeline, we have milestones more associated with Lean. Certainly, we start clear back with the pyramids and the ancients developing weights and measures, craft skills, and then we had the Industrial Revolution, which is really what we know of as the start of modern industry. We had Taylorism, very famous, not well received, but it was the seeds of quality control, scientific management. Then we had Walter Schuchart, a huge player in quality. He's the one that developed control charts, which we'll cover. We had, of course, the famous players Deming and Duran, who really brought statistics into the picture. And we have some other names there that you might want to familiarize yourself with. We have Motorola developing and branding this body of knowledge we call Six Sigma, and Jack Welch making it famous. I think we can trace the beginning of the concepts of Lean quite clearly to Henry Ford in a definitive book called Today and Tomorrow. It was that book that the Japanese, particularly Toyota, took that book and hung on every word of it, and they developed what's known as the Toyota Production System, which is the foundation of modern Lean. And then we have quality authors that have went in and learned about Lean and written books and brought the Toyota Way of Productions, TPS, or the Toyota Production System to the world. And then around 2000, we were in two camps pretty much. Six Sigma and Lean were kind of in two camps. But really around 2000, the efficiency or the obvious value of merging them started to catch on. And we started to integrate Lean and Six Sigma. And we also had in there kind of the concept of total quality management preceding that, which is this idea of a holistic view of the organization where you need to look at all of your not just manufacturing, but accounting and finance. You need to look at your enterprise in a total way and look at quality across the board. And all of this has morphed into Lean Six Sigma. Lean, as we will talk about much more, is to reduce waste, increase velocity. Six Sigma focuses on reducing variation. So in Lean Six Sigma, you have a merging of increasing effectiveness and efficiency and not letting them compete against each other. Again, here we have a reinforcement of some of the milestones that we saw on the timeline. Some of the big players here, I would probably include Deming and Duran here on this list of a few people to bullet out as really the key people in formulation of Lean Six Sigma. Talking about Six Sigma now, proper, the body of knowledge of Six Sigma, the philosophy of Six Sigma, the big word is variation. Variation is the mortal enemy, according to Six Sigma. Variation is what we attack. When we reduce variation, we improve. Particularly, it manifests itself in defects. So variation and defects are the huge targets of Six Sigma. Again, the target of Six Sigma is reduce variation. Fundamental measurement of variation and output from a process is standard deviation. It's denoted by the Greek symbol sigma. Output from a process will vary about a mean, mu. Some processes have more spread or wider than others. Standard deviation gives a measure of the spread of the data. The less spread, the less variation, the better. Here we see here plot of one with a standard deviation sigma 1, the other of 0.5. Both have a mean of 5. What we have here is the foundational distribution of improvement, which is the normal distribution. There are many other distributions. This is the foundational distribution that we work with. They're symmetric and bell-shaped. So in this slide, we see that the distribution with the standard deviation of 0.5 is tighter and would be considered better process output. Here again, we see the normal curve. Now this normal curve is a special kind of normal curve. It's called the standard normal curve. A standard normal curve has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. It would be good to commit to memory. This is called the 68-95-99 rule, 99.7 rule. You should probably try to commit to memory these distributions of data with respect to standard deviations on any normal distribution. In any normal distribution, 68.3% of the data falls within plus or minus one standard deviation from the mean. 95.4% of the data falls within plus or minus two standard deviations of the mean, and 99.7 fall within plus or minus three standard deviations. Now, as you move out in standard deviations, you approach asymptotically 100% of the process. Six standard deviations is accepted as the value that for any practical purpose will encompass the entire process spread. It encompasses, as you see there, 99.99966% of the data, so that only 34 process output data points out of 1 million would lie outside the Six Sigma limits. Specification limits are the ultimate quantification of the voice of the customer. Specification limits are where if you have a process output that goes beyond these limits, you have a defect. Conceptually speaking, in a slightly simplified manner, if you have upper and lower specification limits that happen to be one plus or minus one standard deviation from the mean, you conceptually have a one sigma process. That is, the distance between the mean and the nearest specification limit is one standard deviation. So you have 68.3% yield in your process, with the remainder falling outside of your upper and lower spec limits. Similarly, if you had your spec limits out at two standard deviations, you'd have 95.4% yield, with remainder falling outside of your specification limits. The same if you had 99.7. That's a typo. 99.7% of your product falls within specification limits, you'd have a three sigma process. If your process is producing output that falls within plus or minus six standard deviations of mean, you would have only 3.4 defective parts per million. This is essentially zero defects and would be considered a six sigma level of capability. Although there are a few slight modifications go to the exact calculation of sigma level, but conceptually you'd have a six sigma capability, or a six sigma, a sigma level of six, if you only had 3.4 parts per million, defects per million opportunities. Now, you notice that we use the term sigma to both represent standard deviation and the measure of how many defects you had, or sigma level. Now, this will be a source of continual confusion, that we call sigma standard deviation, and we have sigma level to denote a capability of your process. One thing that helps is if you use the term sigma level when talking about capability, it helps minimize confusion. So when you have a sigma level, which is the Greek term sigma, and it's also based on standard deviations. So it is confusing. And as you work with it a while, you'll start to get used to it. Although it always remains a little bit confusing, at least to me. So again, sigma level is process capability. How many parts, how many output of your process falls within your specification limits or beyond it. If you only have, again, 3.4 million defects per million data output, you have a 6 sigma level of capability. And there you see some typical data on, you can see that there are, would be some organizations and processes and industries where you would want to press hard to try to have almost zero defects or try to achieve very few defects per million opportunities. And if you use a scientific method such as DMAIC, it's considered to be quite feasible and possible. I know that in anesthesiology, major hospitals have certainly obtained beyond a 6 sigma level of critical complications from anesthesia. So many high consequence industries can achieve 6 sigma. Now, most industry, typical industry, they don't necessarily want to try to find 6 sigma performance. They want to target their capability commensurate with the needs of the business. Basic ways to improve capability. You can open the specification limits, or you can narrow the process distribution. Now, the first choice in engineering and in any improvement should be to ask yourself, are you setting your specification limits? Are you setting your requirements too tight? Can you open up your limits, your requirements? And many times you can. And in fact, Motorola, as they had a goal of attaining 6 sigma in all their critical processes, actually Motorola, the first thing they did, and one way they achieved a great measure of their success, was to first try to open up their tolerance or their specification limits on all their processes to the extent that made business sense. Now, if you can open up your specification limits, then you have the harder task of narrowing the process distribution. So you have to use a methodology. DMAIC is Six Sigma methodology, and you need to find root cause to your variation and find ways to reduce that variation to make it tighter so that you have fewer defects per your opportunities. Now here we have a one-page slide of everything you might want to need to know or care about Lean Six Sigma. This is, I believe, a pretty good slide. So let's spend a little bit of time on this. This has several important points to it that might be helpful to you. First, we have the five basic phases of Six Sigma, the DMAIC process that we'll go over. The bulleted points are probably the main critical portions of each phase. So I went through each phase and I chose what I thought was must-have aspects of these phases. If you're doing a project, for example, you'll want to have a charter, a voice of the customer, and at least a high-level process map, probably a SIPOC in your defined phase. We'll learn about these. In measure phase, you're going to measure your problem, have a metric for your critical characteristic you're measuring, or your why, or your problem you're trying to solve. You're going to want to validate your measurement of that, either formally in a gauge R&R, or at least some way to validate to your satisfaction you're measuring things correctly. You're going to understand your capability. What are you doing now? What's your current state capable of doing? And then as you move from measure into analyze, it's essential that you try to identify your potential or your vital, your factors. When you analyze, you're going to form theories. You're going to say to yourself, what's my cause and effect? And you're going to take your hypotheses or your theories of how to improve your project or your problem. And you're going to identify the factors that you think were potential, and you're going to find a way using objective criteria all the way up through statistics or advanced DOE or simpler graphical tools, but you're going to analyze till you get a confidence that you have the vital factors to your problem. Then you're going to select a solution that you think optimizes due to cost and payback, the mitigation of those factors. You're going to design a solution, controls, and you're going to put it into an improvement plan, and you're going to verify that it's working. You're getting your intended results. As you put it into improve, you're going to make sure that as you become satisfied your improvements in place and are obtaining the results expected, you're going to go through the process and find a way to control it. Where are you going to go in and measure your process to make sure that it's staying in a state of control? What are your feedback plan? What's going, if it goes out of state of control, what are you going to do to correct it? What's your action plans to hold the gains? Control charts are a very typical way of a tool and control. You're going to document that, and you're going to choose, then go on to try to replicate your improvements to other processes. In the control, now these are not a linear sequence. Along there, the left side, it's my opinion, it's important to realize these are not necessarily a linear sequence. They're not necessarily done in this order, or the path is not simply one way. In an actual project, your define, measure, analyze, and prove and control kind of merge together. You might have to loop back. Your final charter is usually always different than your beginning charter. And sometimes you work these in parallel, sometimes you kind of work them in a different order. But this is not a recipe. But certainly the principle is to define, measure, analyze, and improve and control your problem. I've found a lot of times, and we'll see another slide that coming up shortly that emphasizes why I'm saying this, but a lot of times you might actually start in the control phase where you're going to go out and you're going to look and see what your current state is, put it in a see if you can put it in a control plan, see if it's in a state of control, whether there's sufficient training and work instructions, understanding in the players that is you have a process that's being repeated by everybody involved, and what's its output. You may end up starting in the control phase. And we talk about the typical pattern of a primary metric here shortly. I'll try to remember to come back to that point. Now, you could also use a plan, do, check, act called the Deming cycle. At least in my mind, I consider it equivalent, and there would be nothing wrong with using PDCA. I prefer define, measure, analyze, proof, and control, and I use that in my mind for lean projects. Lean projects can certainly follow this and certainly do in actuality follow this. All these steps really implicitly or explicitly should be executed in a methodical improvement. When it comes to segregating Six Sigma and Lean again, Six Sigma is associated with impeccable quality. It's quality, it's low variation, low defects, effectiveness. Lean would be associated conceptually with waste, velocity, efficiency. Now, they go hand in hand, and also in modern Lean Six Sigma, more and more safety is going hand in hand with all of this. And they both need to focus on constraints. There's called the theory of constraints, where you look at what is your constraining your process, what's your capability, what's your bottleneck, what's your constraint, what are your vital factors. Over this again a little bit here. This is the fundamental equation of Six Sigma. You have critical to quality equals critical to process. It's driven by that. Your voice of the customer is what defines what's critical to quality, and what's critical to your process is the voice of the process. Your typical quality characteristics you're concerned about are, of course, cost, schedule, and quality. So you're worried about defects, you're worried about cycle time. And the customer defines what's acceptable. And then don't take the word customer too literal. A customer can be an internal customer, an external customer. It can be an inanimate object. A customer can be an upstream process. But whether it's a step in a process or a real person or whether it's internal or external, what's receiving your process output, ultimately the real live customer, but whatever is receiving your output from a process defines what's critical to quality. Now here we see a critical to quality time series plot where you're plotting your primary metric. And the assumption here is that you're going to go from a stable process that's under control, you're going to improve it, and you're going to go down to a new level of improved stability that has less variation and has moved in its mean value to in the direction of goodness. And this goes back to why I said that sometimes many of my projects is probably just best to start control, because all of Lean Six Sigma really kind of assumes to work best, you're really kind of assuming you're starting from some kind of current state that is reasonably stable and reproducible. Now, many times in many situations, you may get into a situation where there's not even a well-defined process yet. So you can certainly start to define and start defining your what you want to do and what you think your gap is and what your target is. But if really, unless you have some kind of process that's reasonably stable and in some kind of state of repeating, you're really not ready to do much productive improvement. So you get you have some quality metric, defects or cycle time, and you see if you plot that output, and you see if you have some process that is at least reasonably reproducing that output, and then you can methodically improve it to a new improved state. This is done project by project. It's never ending. You methodically improve to new states, and you target improvement on critical processes and improve from current state to improved states as the business needs dictate. This is called breakthrough improvement, and I think one term here that when people think of breakthrough, they think about home runs. Breakthrough improvement doesn't necessarily mean some huge stop the presses improvement that's going to save the company. Breakthrough improvement means you take a process, you get it in a state of control, and that you methodically improve it to a new state that's significantly better in performance. So breakthrough doesn't necessarily mean dramatic. It means and sustained. It means you start from one current state, you improve it to a stable, sustained, significantly better level of performance. It doesn't mean, and I think that's important when you speak to management and people in Six Sigma, when they talk about breakthrough, they need to use that word carefully, because management thinks you're going to work some kind of magic. You're just going to stabilize your processes, get them under control, identify which ones need to be improved to best serve the strategy of the business, methodically improve them to a new, significantly better performance, and that's breakthrough in performance. It's done incrementally. It's done continuously. It's consistent with the philosophy of Kaizen and Lean of continual, methodical, never-ending improvement. Process again. We walked through that, gave it a little overview. I think it was on slide 16. Let's walk through it again. Pick out some points about it. Do another walk through to reinforce some things. In the defined phase, a couple of key issues are you want to have a clear statement of the problem. And you want to have that in measurable terms. That's your metric. Your metrics are measured in critical to quality elements or dependent variables Y that are functions of process factors. Your classic measurements for Y, your critical to quality, are defects or cycle time or some measure of quality or time or ratios of those. So you're usually measuring a quality metric or a time metric or some combination of those. And you want to have projects defined in your defined phase that are of manageable scope. The clear tendency is for people to want to overscope projects. When in doubt, scope down. You ought to err on the side of too small a scope. Natural tendency is to want to put too much on your plate at one time. The defined phase almost certainly should have hopefully an explicit or at least a strong implicit statement of the voice of the customer. Again, the customer can be external, internal, can be an inanimate object. But the output of the process is critical to something that receives that output, whether it's a human customer or whether it's another process step. Who is the customer of your process output, and what is his voice? What is his definition of what he needs in terms of critical to him, critical to his division of quality or efficiency or acceptability? In the measure phase, you're going to collect data to verify your why. And you're going to want to try to make some kind of measurement of your process capability. So you're going to want to be sure that the why that you measured in the defined phase is reasonably accurate, and then you're going to assess what your process capability is. Usually that's literal. There's capability indices or sigma level, or it can be other ways that you measure the capability or benchmark capability of your process. Your measured why in your defined phase really should translate to a cost of poor quality or a benefit or a dollar value. So when you're in your defined phase, as we'll see later, you do make an estimate of your benefit, and the measure phase is where you start to refine your estimate of the benefit you're going to achieve when you improve your process output or your why. You're going to want to, in your measure phase, explicitly through formal gauge R&R or measurement system analysis, that you validate your measurement system is giving you a reliable measure of your critical quality dependent variable Y. At the very least, you should do something that, whether it's a formal gauge R&R or not, you should do something that gives the team and yourself confidence that you have a reasonable and reliable, reproducible and repeatable measurement of your dependent variable that you're trying to improve. And again, you're going to want to start to find ways to demonstrate your value in Lean Six Sigma, particularly the Six Sigma side of it. The philosophy is you want to always demonstrate your value, and the universal language of value is dollars. So you try to translate everything in terms of all value from improvement in terms of dollars. Whether what we call hard, true bottom line dollars or soft dollars, such as savings for morale or efficiency or safety, that you can convert to dollars later, which would be soft dollars. You try to convert things to dollar value. You're trying to understand the cost of your poor quality and how that translates into dollars. Now, also in the measure phase, in addition to verifying your why, you begin to identify your voice of the process or your X factors that are critical to improving your Y. And you want to begin to collect data on those targeted X factors. Again, as you would see in practice, the delineation of the dividing line between these phases is not that hard, not that solid, not that linear. As you begin to define and measure things, as you start to measure, you will refine your definition of things as you go on. It's a continuum. Now, in an analyzed phase, what you're going to do is you're going to take those process factors that you believe have the highest potential to be the critical factors or the most limiting or constraining factors to the quality of your why, and prove that they are the most critical factors. Now, there's levels of analysis. The first level that we all use, and that is used implicitly in all improvement, whether it's done by Lean Six Sigma professionals or quality professionals or anybody, is in normal everyday life is going to use expert opinion and judgment. Just judgment and opinion, or expert opinion, in the case of somebody experienced in a process. That's level one, and that's never going to go away, and of course it's very valuable. Many process improvement projects never do go beyond on level one. You can look at a process, map it out. Experts can make opinions and judgment about the process improvements. You can put them in place, check them out, check and act on them and see if they pan out. The next level that usually you would go to if you formed a team and chartered a project to formally improve a process, either its quality or its cycle time, it's likely that you'll at least move to level two on a team where you take your expert opinion and you collect data, and then you begin the process of using decision-making based on evidence, evidence-based decision-making. So you start to collect some data in addition to the expert judgment. And in addition, level three would be these first three levels, including level three, probably any significant project would go to level three, to where you'd collect data and do graphical analysis, do some histograms, some box plots, Pareto charts, which we'll go over, are almost always used in projects. So simple graphical analysis is probably going to be helpful to take your data, sort it out in a way that helps you analyze it and make your opinions and your judgments. Now, as you move into more sophisticated problems that are a little more complex in nature, a little bit more high consequence, then you start to move into statistical analysis, hypothesis testing, regression analysis, analysis of control charts, and other tools of statistical analysis. And then level five is, if you really need to dig into something and get to the bottom of something, and you have multiple factors and there's interactions and among these factors, and it's very unclear even after statistical analysis what your best course of action are, you can do design of experiments. Actually design experiments and use advanced analysis of variance and determine which are your critical factors and how they interact. So those are the level of analysis. Again, one to three would be almost always expected in a project that was led by a black belt or even a yellow belt. And then you start to move into level four, of course, many times. There's where you'd want somebody, a black belt involved if you're going to get into statistical analysis. The yellow belt may or may not be, or green belt may or may not be completely comfortable with some of the tools, and the black belt would be involved. And then design of experiments gets to be where you really take some time and lay out some statistical investigation. Then you move into the improve phase and you select improvements based on your analysis. You would put together an improvement plan, and part of that improvement plan would hopefully include ways that you're going to test, verify that your implementations have been put in place and are achieving the correct results. And a big part of that is control. Improve and control start to merge together as you formulate your improvements and you select them and you begin your plan to implement them and test them for effectiveness. It starts to blend in with control, because control is where you really validate the improvement. You create a plan to hold the grains, make sure it doesn't slip back. Control charts are a classic tool in the control phase. So in control, you will check and act, basically, on your improvements, and hopefully they become institutionalized and stabilized, and you see, you do a final validation and verification of what's working and why it's working Is it working as intended, and is it being sustained out over time? Well, that kind of that ended the overview of Six Sigma. Now we'll go over lean foundations and principles. Now, this is kind of a one-slide summary of everything you need to want to know about lean. So let's spend a little time on this slide. We'll go over it, and then we'll go through some concepts slide by slide. Lean focuses on efficiency, elimination of waste, increased flow, increased velocity, balance of the process. Where Six Sigma focused on effectiveness, which was defects, where defects were believed to be the result of variation. So on one side, Six Sigma is quality on defects, and lean focuses on velocity and flow. Now here's some pillars in the house of lean. And let's go through some of these terms. I don't know we'll cover them in the rest of the lectures to a great degree, but should you be asked about lean or questions on your exam, will perhaps be familiar with some of these terms. Lean is just in time. It's a form of mitigating waste and eliminating work in process. As we'll discuss further, work in process is considered a waste. It's considered a significant waste. So you try to, both in your process steps and delivery to your process, have materials for your process delivered just in time for it to be worked. And this relates to the concept of pull, where the customer demand, their demand or the capacity, the output per minute that you need to have, your throughput, should be pulled one piece at a time. The ultimate goal in lean is to have one piece flow through your process at a time and have it match exactly demand. That's the holy grail, the theoretical ideal. So if you pull one piece through just to match demand, where all inventory comes into all process steps just in time, you're going to have maximized flow and velocity. This is related to rhythm, or a concept called takt time, or the beat of the drum, which we'll talk about shortly. Some things that help you eliminate waste, keep your process going so that you have minimum cycle time, is single minute exchange of dies. That's SMED. And what that is literally, that you can go into a machine or a setup and you can videotape it and take data on it and put a team together, and you can minimize your setup time. And it also represents the general philosophy of making sure that you're flexible and agile. And certainly setups is one of the areas where being agile is important. Another huge concept in lean is empowerment. Organizations that truly want to improve and have taken lean serious empower their people. People at the process level are those who best know what the problems with the work are and how to improve it, how to make it more efficient. This is also a key principle in safety and human performance improvement. The people doing the job, the ones on the front line, know what the landmines in the process are. Lean is a team-based improvement methodology, just like Six Sigma. It's continuous improvement. That's the word Kaizen. And lean relies on communication. They rely on daily communication. The philosophy of lean is to have short daily meetings at the beginning of the workday to understand what the team needs to do that day to best do the work, and if there should be any changes to standard work. Lean relies on standardizing best practice. But the key thing with lean is that does not become static. Your best practice can change on a daily basis, and it's critical that you communicate. Lean believes in built-in quality. You design quality in. That is related to the lean term pokey yoke, which is air proofing or building quality in, finding ways to in your processes and your product to make sure that you build quality in. You can't inspect quality out. You can't inspect problems out. You have to build quality in. Lean is very visual. They use one-page summaries like this. This is, might be called an A3 summary. A3 summaries are one-page summaries of critical information that a team needs to do a particular, to achieve a particular objective. You can have one-page summaries of Lean. You can have one-page summaries of your project. You can have one-page summaries of your result. You can have postings of how your cell should look, how your work should look. You should have postings of how your workspace should look. Lean is very visual. We rely heavily on visual. Error proofing is pokey yoke. It's related to built-in quality. You address that in the process step, the concept of quality and error proofing. It's a step by step. Every step with empowered people at each step build in quality step by step. TPM is total productive maintenance. It is a concept of preventive maintenance, except there's much more to it. You have teams that go and look at machines, data on reliability, mean time to failures, what machines are loaded. You look at statistics on when they should be serviced. You do logical database preventive maintenance and load balancing. And it's preventive maintenance with a holistic and data-driven and methodology behind total preventive maintenance. So the three concepts there of Lean are MUDA, which is waste or friction, and we'll talk about the eight wastes that gets a lot of press, but we also have constraints or Murray, which is the theory of constraints fits in here. You need to look at where your bottlenecks are, focus on constraints. And that all relates to waste and making sure that your process is accommodating your constraints will lead to MURA, which is flow. So you don't want to have unevenness in your flow. You want to have smooth flow with your constraints in the system being accommodated by the process with very little waste. So that's Lean in one slide. We'll talk here about it a little further depth. Concepts for Lean. Lean's a systematic approach to identifying and eliminating waste, non-value-added activities through continuous improvement by increasing flow, pull of the customer, pulling the product through the process with minimum waste, minimum WIP, waste flow balance again. Key term, non-value added. A term that describes a process step or function that is not required for the direct achievement of the process output. This step or function is identified and examined for potential elimination. Well, there's many definitions of non-value. This is one. Value adds anything the customer is willing to pay for and done right the first time. Everything else is non-value added. Here's down here another definition of value added that could be useful. Useful work that transforms the form, fit, or function of a product or material or service to meet customer requirements and the customer is willing to pay for it. And it's done right the first time, and non-value added is everything else. So value added is things that actually get the product made and most everything we do in a process to create an output from a process doesn't really transform or do useful work to the product. It's just a fact of nature and life. In a typical process, if we're not methodically and trying to be efficient in our process, 95% of the total process time can be non-value added, our typical numbers. You can't really eliminate non-value added by this strict definition. And some non-value added is required by the business, required by law, required by the laws of physics. So if you get down to a process that only has 60% non-value added, you've probably got a process just slickest thing you'll probably ever get. We have to inspect. It's a reality. We have to adjust things. We have to move things around. You're only going to be able to limit yourself to so much pure value added. But that is the goal. And you need to go in and reduce waste. Well, Lean and Six Sigma fosters morale and teamwork. It's cross-training, particularly in Lean. Cross-training employees is a valued concept. Employees participate in decisions and solutions that work, impact their work. This is certainly a Lean concept. Clean and well-organized. Well-marked, safe work areas. Flow instead of batch and queue. You want to reduce WIP, minimize WIP, pull systems that pull a product through to the demand of the customer. You want reduced lead times, reduced cycle times, reduced setup times, reduced down times. And you want flow, smoothness, minimal waste. And of course, that includes minimal defects. Here's some more terms from Lean. Let's just go through them so that you've heard them and know about them. We covered them in that one slide to start the conversation on Lean. Most of these, I see not all of them. Just in time, we covered that. Minimize WIP, pull it through to the demand of the customer, and that's related to one piece flow or pull. Total preventive maintenance is a holistic, methodical, team-based solution to keeping machinery up, optimized in the maximum amount of time possible based on statistics and team-based decision-making. Single-minute exchange of dies, we've talked about that. And it's, globally speaking, it's the concept of being agile and flexible. But single minute exchange of dies really literally also is in manufacturing, trying to minimize your setup time. Pokeyoke is arrow proofing. Kanban is a signal. Kanban sometimes seems like an esoteric word. When you study Lean, a lot of times they'll call about Kanbans, Kanban cards. Actually, they're probably outdated now, but Kanban is the concept of signaling when you need materials for your process. You don't like to want to have a bunch of materials stored up. When you need material to get your process going, you have signals throughout your process to minimize WIP. So whether they're a computer or they're literally Kanban cards, Toyota used to use cards called Kanban cards. And that concept, that hence the name, but it's the concept of signaling and communication in the process between humans and machines or information and computers to make sure that you have minimum work in process in the system and that you got flow and smoothness and don't have a buildup of unnecessary materials or information or people. Value stream mapping is process mapping. It's a process mapping technique that has some unique symbols related to Lean, and we'll go over value stream mapping. It's basically a form of process mapping. Kaizen is the concept of continuous, patient, methodical improvement. Kaizen Blitz is, or also known as a Kaizen workshop, where we do rapid improvement, and also known as a rapid improvement event, is where you bring a cross-functional team together and you do some preparation and you spend between 2 to 4 days in a team-based workshop, going value stream mapping a process and going over the process and improving it and presenting your recommendations to management, and so that you can do incremental improvement with the team over a course of a few days. Now there's prep time for the 3 or 4 days, and then there's follow-on implementation time. But the actual working time to analyze and develop a set of solutions is done 3 or 4 days. Theory of constraints. That's the concept of looking for vital factors or what's your constraint. Your throughput is controlled by your least capable process. So whatever your process is that is your limiting process will limit the throughput to your system. So you need to go methodically look at your constraining process steps and attack those first. 5S is a form of organization. It's widely, it comes from Lean, the Toyota production system, which pretty much define modern lean. It's where you can, well, we will go over 5S. It's where you organize your workspace on a team-based, project-based. You often in a Kaizen Blitz type environment, you go through and you do a 5S to identify waste in your or in your area, organize it, clean it, standardize it, and sustain it. Very helpful to safety and efficiency. Again, lean is very visual. It's likes to focus on visual signals, visual organization, signs and posters that show people at a glance what they need to know. And then the 8 wastes, or how lean usually categorizes some of the major categories of waste, and we'll be covering that. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the integration of Lean and Six Sigma. From the aspect of your practicing as a yellow belt, and from the aspect of taking an examination, becoming certified, there's probably not going to be a lot of questions that really interrogate your understanding of the integration of Lean and Six Sigma. However, there's probably, in my mind, this is a huge topic, so we'll spend a little time on it. You should understand it. Lean and Six Sigma are now integrated. I was in process improvement part-time when I was an engineer for 20 years, and we did process improvement. And when I started to become more and more involved in process improvement back in the early 2000 time frame, I heard about Lean, I heard about Six Sigma, and personally I was amazed that they were separated. Well, by the time I continued to focus on process improvement to the point where it became my career, I was fortunate enough to work in an organization to be trained as a black belt, where we did understand and we fully integrate, made every attempt to fully integrate Lean and Six Sigma. I still to this day am a little surprised how the two are continue to be siloed when I go out and about and talk to quality professionals. If you silo Lean and you silo Six Sigma, you're leaving a tremendous amount of money on the table. I try to practice Lean Six Sigma. I do have not have a bias. And I try to the best that I can, working to be a practicing black belt, to understand and use Lean Six and Six Sigma concepts integrated to the best effect of improving a process. Six Sigma and Lean have a huge overlap. This Venn diagram, it's just a symbolic representation. It's probably not big enough in the common tools and concepts, but certainly they share the basic quality tools. They shared a reliance on evidence-based decision-making on data. They share the reliance on looking for constraints. Six Sigma calls them the vital factors. Lean calls them the constraints. Six Sigma does have a little more reliance at times on statistics. Or I wouldn't say reliance. It's been Six Sigma has tended to be associated with statistics a little more than lean. But certainly there's many things in lean that you would do that would benefit just as much from the statistics and finding how to get your process to flow as it does to finding a root cause and defects. So you have effectiveness, variation, defects, and statistics, again, on the Six Sigma side. Efficiency, velocity, flow, waste, and cycle time are kind of the lean concepts. It's my opinion, which I have a lot of confidence in, that anyone that wants to go out and become go into quality with respect to process, organizational, enterprise improvement, and they do not embrace both bodies of knowledge with equal enthusiasm, they are, again, going to be leaving a lot of money on the table. They have integrated. If you don't speak in integrated terms, you're probably behind the times. And both have their philosophies, but at the end, I personally do not see any conflicts whatsoever between Six Sigma and Lean. They say the same thing in a different language. And actually that's true about safety also. Safety, Six Sigma, Lean. The language of these three bodies of knowledge are saying the same thing, and they have a very complementary and synergistic nature to them and should be integrated. Slides. I may have just covered much of this. Lean and Six Sigma have the general purpose of providing a customer with best possible quality, cost, and delivery. And again, it's always good to remind ourselves that when we talk about the customer, it's not always just the external customer, but the recipient of process output, ultimately leading to the external customer, has to be the best quality, and it has to be done as efficiently as possible. Again, lean does tend to get associated with less technical tools, although many lean practitioners are going to rely on design of experiments if they have a problem with their production system. So the whole continuum of Lean Six Sigma, you can get pretty sophisticated in lean objectives if you really want to. But lean has been associated with simple teams getting together, doing 5S events to organize their workspace, Kaizen Blitz to look at their processes. Six Sigma tends to get associated with more of the statistics, the hypothesis testing, and regression testing, things like that. It's an association, but really it just depends on the problem. You're either focusing on solving defects and trying to hold your cycle time constant or not hurt your time, or you're looking at time and not trying to hurt your quality. So it's all one big happy family. They both emphasize, and this is very important, they both emphasize facts, data, methodology, and tools. This isn't, Lean and Six Sigma is not about management getting together and say, hey, they made me manager for a reason, so this is what we need to do. It's about the employees who are on the job, knowing what the landmines are, what the problems are, using methodology, tools, and data to help management understand what the constraints are and what you need to do to improve your processes. They both require strong management support. That's a bit of an understatement. If management doesn't understand Lean Six Sigma, isn't committed to it, it probably isn't going to go anywhere. They need persistence in implementation and execution. So this last bullet, anybody who's practiced Lean Six Sigma probably, certainly myself, will affirm the requirement that management support it, management understand it, management be committed to it, and that the organization has to be persistent in implementation execution. That underlying that is the whole con that underlies the whole concept of continual improvement. Continual improvement and persistence get to be synonymous to a certain extent. Now, I'll probably lecture from the viewpoint of someone who's worked in a fairly large organization, but I would think that this would be a typical roles, responsibilities, and organizational arrangement for a company of any size, really. It would just vary in the amount of people involved and the degree which you each was responsible in detail for the various functions. You're probably going to have generally a Six Sigma Lean Six Sigma organization is going to have an executive team who want to adopt and launch the program and keep it sustained. They're going to commit to Lean Six Sigma, and they're going to set direction and vision and mission. You'll probably find that their commitment will lead their understanding. Hopefully, eventually they'll commit to it and they'll understand it, and that they will continue to help it thrive in the organization. You probably have some sort of governance committee, and I'll show you a visual of this, but they're going to want to understand the types of priority, but the types of projects that have potential in the organization, the kind of problems that have been chronic and continual and hard to solve and have a high payback, and are going to want to gauge these projects against their strategic and business objectives. So the governance committee, the managers and executives in charge of the program are going to want to monitor and select the projects. Then, once you get below management directive and management commitment and management organization that assures that projects are aligning with strategic goals, you're going to have your expertise base. So you're going to have people in the organization, perhaps if it's large enough, like in the company that I've had experience in, that you're going to have a whole group of people responsible for providing and disseminating the methodology. So you're going to have master black belts, probably a handful even in a large company, and then you could have numerous black belts. The general rule of thumb, which seems to be from my experience so far a reliable indicator, is you're probably going to about 0.5% to 1% of all your employees are black belts. You may have the expertise base, your black belts run by a director, and that director most likely and probably preferably would be a Master Lean Six Sigma black belt. You may utilize consultants for your training, and you may have a dissemination of directors helping with the execution of improvement projects throughout the different business units of your organization. And it's probably going to be some combination of centralized expertise and disseminated expertise, and some combination of those among your various business units. All this is dependent on the size of your company. Obviously, this scales down. If it's a small company, your management is going to talk directly to a couple of key managers who are going to want to drive the program, and there are going to be a few black belts and trained people in the organization and help serve both the projects. And then, of course, if you have a huge company like GE or General Motors, you're going to have an executive team, you have many governance committees, you're going to have hundreds of black belts, dozens of master black belts. If the company has embraced a Lean Six Sigma philosophy, and it is thriving. To a governing body or governing committee, they're going to be consulting the black belts, the people that do the improvement, have the experience training in Lean Six Sigma improvement, and they're all talking together to see what kind of projects we have and how we're going to set things up. And then at each business unit has a certain level of expertise, their own local black belts, maybe a local director. And that's how the whole program's coming together. Here we have a slide discusses roles and responsibility at the project level. Usually, always need to have a champion. In fact, you have to have a champion. It's an executive or manager with sufficient authority to assume teams, that assures team success, help assure team success, and implementation of team recommendations. He's the fellow that has enough authority that once the team has a set of potential improvements that have been validated and verified sufficiently to give it a try, he can make it so. He can make the changes happen, and he can also help you get resources, help you with barriers, help you with roadblocks. He's got a formal authority to help the team achieve their objectives. You usually have a team leader that works with the, you may have a black belt could be the team leader, and he really leads as a project manager. You may also have a leader on the team who's really the one most to gain by solving the problem or completing the project. So the black belt may help lead the team, and that probably will be in the capacity of a project manager, improvement project manager, and you may also have someone who helps a black belt actually be the team leader in a traditional sense. In that case, if you have a strong enough team leader who understands process improvement, the black belt may take the role of facilitator, and where he's the expert in problem-solving methods, and he'll help teach, coach the team. Or you may have a facilitator that is not the black belt. The key point about this is as the team is being led through the improvement process, it's essential that someone's there to keep them to the discipline of the methodology. So, of course, this lecture assumes that the chosen methodology of the organization is Lean Six Sigma, and somebody has to be there to discipline the team that they need to solve it in reasonably consistent to the methodology of Lean Six Sigma. They just can't wing it. Now, you're always going to want to definitely have a process owner on the team as a team member. Now, that's either a business manager or a leadership position, or he's a delegate of a manager or leadership that has a responsibility for owning the process. So he can understand the process and can change the process. The team is cross-functional team members. You're going to have a team comprised of subject matter experts from the various disciplines relevant to your project. And they're going to meet regularly. A typical would be 2 hours a week for the life of the project, where projects can vary from 3 months to a year. Typical time frames if you're trying to do it, what might be called a Six Sigma project, where you're looking for root causes to a specific and necessary quality problem, or you can have shorter projects that eliminate waste, help mitigate constraints, and move the processes in the direction of goodness with a little less rigor. Those are more on the lean side. But you're always going to have a team comprised of cross-functional subject experts. Now, the distinction between a team member and a subject matter expert is you're going to have people that need to be aware of the team, need to go to the reviews, need to be have buy-in from the champion, has their buy-in, they're going to support the team, and they support the team on an ad hoc basis. They know they're on call, and when the team calls them and asks them to come to a meeting or help them, it's expected the subject matter expert will know that the project's going on, will know enough about the project that he can step in and give the consultation that he needs to give to help the project move forward. Master black belts in an organization are consultants, trainers, and experts. They can be external consultants. They provide the technical support and mentoring to the black belts. They facilitate multiple projects. Oftentimes they're the ones that are given complex projects because they have experience. They provide advice to champions in executive management. They train others. That's a big one. Master black belts tend to be the ones that do quite a bit of training. That's one way they advance in the skills of Lean Six Sigma. They tend to be looked up to provide leadership to management with respect to implementation and organization of Lean Six Sigma to help achieve the business strategy. In going along with that, they help align the projects to the organization's strategic and operational plans. The champion and the sponsor, we talked about the champion. He oversees, supports, implements the efforts of the team. Champion and sponsor get used interchangeably. It would be on a case basis, local nomenclature, whether people are calling them champions or sponsors, or whether there's a distinction between the two. They're pretty much the same kind of concept, somebody high enough in the organization to help the team get together, get the resources they need, finish the job of finding out what the high potential improvement possibilities are, and helping them get implemented and putting them in a state of control. That takes somebody with formal authority. The champion identifies black belts that he would like to bring in on his projects. He selects the projects, brings the black belt in. A champion really is preferable. You can have champions training. It's preferable that managers who are going to champion improvement projects understand the use of Lean Six Sigma, not just be committed to it or approve of it, but they really should understand it. He monitors and facilitates the project, and again, he provides the approval and support to implement. And he's going to be the one who, at the end of the project, springs for the recognition and award. You're going to want somebody with some budget and willing to peel off a few greenbacks to reward everybody with some, shirts and dinners, and even eventually make sure that managers have of the team members understand the participation they made, and it's reflected on a performance appraisal. So you have short-term and long-term reward. You want people to be rewarded for improving the organization, both in the short-term with parties and pizza, and in the long-term with their performance appraisal reflecting the fact that they are participating in continuous improvement. Black belt is he's an expert in Lean and Six Sigma. He's usually always considered a change agent. A black belt needs to align project to business objectives. If a black belt's working on a project, he needs to understand and be able to articulate quickly how that lines up with the business objectives. He helps manage, prioritize, select, charter, and launch projects. They are usually always have some strong leadership role in the project. At least it works best if they do, because the team is going to want to use the methodology. Hopefully, at a minimum, or most of the time, really, it's best if they are the project manager. They take the project, they set it up, they manage it, they know the work breakdown structure, how it should go, what the timelines are. Whether they actually lead the team meeting by meeting or not is situational, and they certainly can, or they can be a facilitator. But usually, if they're on the team, they're probably going to want to take ownership of the management of the project one way or another. They teach, they mentor to all levels of the organization, particularly training in green belt level, yellow belt level. Process owner is an important concept on every team. You're going to want a somebody who feels they own the process, understand the process, have a vested interest in the process, and know how to change the process. Could be a business manager or his delegate, and they should be high enough in the organization to make decisions on the process under question. They're a key team member. A process owner is a team member. They help the teams understand the current process, the limitations of what can be changed. They help find the vital factors or the constraints for improvement, and they're the ones that know how to overcome barriers, or at least they're particularly in a good position to go to the champion and work with the champion to overcome barriers. They're very important with respect to once the improvement's been put in place and it's been verified that it's working as intended, and it's been validated that it's achieving the intended benefit. As it goes, as you goes out into time, they're the ones that are going to want to keep it in a state of control and hold the gains over the long term. They're the ones that are key to institutionalizing the improved state or the future state. They're the ones that are going to understand what kind of work instructions and training is necessary to achieve the future state and put in and sustain it. They're the ones really responsible for project documentation at the completion of the project, which oftentimes, particularly in manufacturing, but not necessarily limited to manufacturing, will be ongoing use of control charts. Green belts and yellow belts are both people who've been trained in Lean Six Sigma and certified, but have not gone on to make a career change or specialize in Lean Six Sigma. They may lead projects part-time. Black belts definitely appreciate green belts or yellow belts who are willing to help lead a project and help with the tools and help educate people in Lean Six Sigma. They're going to tend to be ones, if they're not leading, to be on a lot of teams. Now, I mentioned earlier that you might expect 0.5% to 1% of all your employees to be black belts. Well, it would be very advantageous to the organization if everybody in the organization had at least team member training. And I'm just throwing out a personal opinion. It would behoove the organization if over half all the employees were yellow belts, and certainly you had near 100% of the organization had been trained in team member training, which is going to give basic Lean Six Sigma education in the methodology. Now, this is a kind of a visual of much we talked about with roles and responsibilities. That little funnel over there where you have prospects, quality, verify, charter, that's the hopper. The hopper is a common term, or the funnel or the hopper, project hopper, funnel, typical terms. You have prospects for improvement projects coming in, and you qualify management working with executives in the black belt. You start to qualify the projects and you start to do a little screening and you find evidence to show you what's your payback, is it a good fit, you verify it, it's good for the organization, it's the right time, we have the right resources. And then as it goes through the interview process, it goes through the candidate process, eventually you'll get chartered. And along that funnel, as it comes out the funnel, you're probably going to know whether you're going to do a Lean Kaizen event, or if it's going to be a full-blown root cause quality domain problem, or if it's just going to be a just do it, where you've got a project that you've realized as it's gone through the funnel or the hopper or the or the organizational project grinder there, that it's important, and that you don't need a cross-functional team, but you do charter it, and a manager on his own local work area will take care of the project. All these projects, as they go through the funnel, need to line up with the strategy, tactics, and objectives of the business. They need to line up with the vision and objectives of the customer. A champion will be a big player in helping projects move through funnels, especially when it comes to taking one that comes out and chartering it with a black belt. A master black belt or black belt will help work with customers and executives and champions and process owners to hopefully that you'll get a nice blend of projects going out into the organization, addressing organizational problems and improving them appropriately.